Amidst the chaos, negotiations, and counter-protests surrounding COP26 in early November, arose promises to be better in terms of emissions and environmental destruction. Hundreds of countries pledged to halt deforestation by 2030, while leaders across the world vowed to reach net zero emissions targets by certain dates. In the case of India, Prime Minister Modi shocked the gathered negotiators with an ambitious pledge to achieve net zero emissions by 2070, while the United Kingdom has championed a net zero by 2050 plan. The list of net zero targets goes on, but there's a problem. Net zero emissions can mean vastly different scenarios depending on the context. Theoretically, India, the UK, or even fossil fuel companies that set net zero emission targets can continue spewing out greenhouse gases under the claim that future carbon capture technologies will make up for all of their emissions. So today we unpack the implications of net zero pledges. What they mean, whether they're effective tools, and whether they might actually be doing more harm than good. This video is sponsored by CuriosityStream, which now comes with Nebula for free when you sign up using the link in the description. A decade ago, an idea was brewing. One that was meant to encapsulate the dual task of simultaneously reducing emissions and capturing greenhouse gases out of the air. The concept of net zero climate targets took root quickly during the Paris climate negotiations. Net zero became the new climate buzz phrase for political and corporate leaders alike. In theory, a net zero strategy is a promising development. When approached correctly, Professor of Economics Matthew Potts and PhD candidate Oliver Miltenberger write that for a country or corporation to achieve net zero emissions, it must identify and report all emissions it is responsible for creating, it then reduces them as much as possible, and then if it still has emissions it cannot reduce, it invests in projects that either prevent emissions elsewhere or pull carbon out of the air to reach a quote-unquote net zero balance. Balance on paper. In short, the ideal path towards a net zero target must foreground emissions reductions. And then when all options for reductions are exhausted, carbon sequestration techniques can be used as a last resort. The problem with net zero goals, however, is that there is no standard. One company may not even reduce its emissions at all and rely on future carbon capture technologies, while a country might heavily reduce greenhouse gas output and only supplement with carbon negative options at the way end. In most cases, however, net zero climate targets are just a buzz phrase for procrastinating until the very last second. Or in the words of the satirical government ad by the YouTube channel The Juice Media,
net zero by 2050 means that instead of being honest this decade by taking this path, we leave the being honest part to the last minute by taking that path instead.
Because net zero can mean so many things, countries and corporations use these targets to continue polluting and turning a profit on the bet that some massive carbon capture infrastructure will suck up their emissions at the 11th hour. Net zero is yet another procrastination tactic, plain and simple. And who better but oil and gas giant BP to show us why net zero is a scam? In February of 2020, as COVID-19 began to shake the world, the CEO of BP stepped up onto a podium surrounded by press and announced something seemingly monumental. The fossil fuel giant BP would achieve net zero emissions by 2050. At first glance, this sounds extremely promising. A major oil company was going to rid themselves of fossil fuels. For those who remembered BP's greenwashed Beyond Petroleum campaign in the early 2000s, however, this felt like deja vu. Much like two decades ago, BP's new green initiative seems to be green in words only. A look behind the oil company's new eco-drenched slogans and flashy green graphics reveals very little has changed in their business practices. First of all, their net zero claims only apply to direct emissions caused by drilling and processing oil and gas, and not from consumer side emissions of their product like car exhaust. This means that BP could claim zero emissions by completely reducing their emissions from operations without even considering the polluting destruction of their gasoline or natural gas. But the thing is, BP isn't even reducing the emissions of their infrastructure and refineries. Under the label of net zero, BP can continue emitting as long as it offsets those emissions with massive tree planting operations that are often rife with complications, or some future carbon sequestration technology that is yet to be tested at scale. In theory, this means that BP can continue business as usual practices up until 2049, and then in the last year, try to suck up all the emissions it has created by planting trees and using currently unrealized carbon capture technologies. What's more likely, however, is that when 2049 hits, BP will just push the target further into the future, and in doing so, lull us further into inaction. To add insult to injury, BP's pledge excludes more than 40% of its oil production and 15% of its gas production. A report from Inside Climate News reveals that the BP pledge would only cut the emissions intensity of their products by less than 30%. But even here, BP is using wordplay to disguise inaction. Emissions intensity is not the same as emissions. French fossil fuel giant Total, for example, cut their emissions intensity by 6%, but its total emissions rose by 8%. And with a target 30 years in the future and very little enforcement protocols, BP can push the consequences of its climate destruction down the line, all while profiting off its green image. In short, net zero emissions doesn't mean zero emissions, and BP knows it. BP is an extreme example of how companies abuse the loopholes of the net zero framework. But in a capitalist global economy, profit and competition incentivizes this kind of greenwashing and political trickery. Under capitalism, it's easier to make more money claiming you're not polluting than actually not polluting. As we've just seen, most net zero climate targets fail to truly face the climate crisis head on. Instead of focusing on emissions reductions, which is a sure way of minimizing the amount of greenhouse gases in the air, net zero plans often rely on carbon capture and sequestration strategies, which either come in the form of natural offsetting through tree planting or technologies like direct air capture, which are currently impractical at scale. In the case of nature-based sequestration, most offsetting is doing more harm than good. In a ProPublica investigative piece, journalist Lisa Song writes, "If the world were graded on the historic reliability of carbon offsets, the result would be a solid F." She goes on to cite reports like a 2015 paper revealing that 75% of carbon offsets from one carbon trading scheme were unlikely to represent real reductions, and that if countries had cut pollution on site instead of relying on offsets, global carbon emissions would have been 600 million tons lower. In addition, natural sequestration in the form of tree planting and forest preservation are fueling new forms of green colonialism. Buying up and quote-unquote preserving huge tracts of land, often in the imperial periphery, corporations and countries push local residents off of forests or grasslands that they might have lived on for decades. But even if those nature-based carbon sequestration schemes were somehow effective, the sheer scale needed to make up for business-as-usual emissions is ecologically impossible. In its quest to achieve net zero emissions by 2050, Royal Dutch Shell plans to deploy more carbon offsets by 2030 than were available globally in 2019. And that's just for one company and won't even make up for all of Shell's emissions. So at the end of the day, net zero targets are greenwashing at best, and at worst, they work to lock in decades of inaction and give rise to colonial land grabs masquerading as carbon sequestration schemes. Given the inefficacy of net zero, how do we carve a path towards real zero emissions? Future goals must be focused on eliminating emissions. There's no two ways about it. Only ambitious emissions reduction schemes from the imperial core and multinational corporations can pull us back from the precipice of climate chaos. Real zero emissions targets force us to come to grips with destructive capitalist pursuits. This means keeping all fossil fuels in the ground. It also means building a 100% renewable world instead of fossil fuels, replacing industrial agriculture with agroecological permaculture, and embracing a simpler life instead of a consumerist one. But while we strive for a real zero world, we must reduce the harm of false net zero targets. That means pushing for transparent pathways, tangible milestones, or even, as one paper argues, separating targets for emissions reductions and negative emissions. Because at their core, net zero targets are a gamble. And if we're playing for the lives of billions of people, that gamble just isn't worth the risk. If you want to learn a little bit more about green colonialism and the consequences of carbon offsetting, I've made a bonus section examining real-world examples. But it didn't mesh well with this video, so instead I've uploaded that section as an extended edition of this video on the streaming platform my creator friends and I built called Nebula. The bonus content replaces this ad because there aren't any ads on Nebula. And you'll not only see a lot of extended editions, exclusive content, and ad-free videos over on Nebula from me, but also from channels like Second Thought, who just released the first episode of his Nebula original series exploring the history, ideology, and contemporary resurgence of fascism. It's amazing and I highly recommend watching it. But at its core, Nebula allows viewers to support creators directly so they don't have to worry about the pesky YouTube algorithm. Nebula is awesome, but it's now made even better with our partnership with CuriosityStream. CuriosityStream is the go-to streaming platform for thousands of top-tier documentaries, like the two-part series Climate Change by the Numbers, which dives into how we are able to understand and track the climate crisis. And because CuriosityStream loves supporting educational creators, we worked out a deal where if you sign up with the link below, not only do you get access to CuriosityStream, but you'll also get Nebula for free. And this isn't a trial. You'll have Nebula as long as you're a CuriosityStream member. What's even better is that CuriosityStream is offering a special deal for my viewers, 26% off their annual plan. That's a little over $1 a month for both CuriosityStream and Nebula. By signing up, you not only directly support our changing climate, but you gain access to thousands of documentaries and exclusive videos from your favorite creators. So if you want to support both our changing climate and hundreds of other educational content creators, go to curiositystream.com/OCC or click the link in the description and sign up for CuriosityStream and Nebula for just $14.79 per year. That's 26% off. Thanks so much for watching all the way to the end. If you've already signed up for CuriosityStream, you can also support me by becoming an Our Changing Climate patron on Patreon. Just pledging $1 a month allows me the flexibility to keep making more videos like this. So thanks again for watching, and I'll see you in 2 weeks.